Distinguished future physicians, welcome to Stomp on Step 1, the only free video series that helps you study more efficiently by focusing on the highest yield material. I'm Brian McDaniel, and I will be your guide on this journey through parasites. This is the second video in my playlist covering all of the microbiology for the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board exam. We're going to review the most important parasites, such as malaria, various GI protozoa, toxoplasmosis, and pinworm, as well as some high-yield treatment options for these diseases. Parasites are organisms that live in or on a host. These organisms gain some sort of survival advantage, such as gaining nutrients, while their presence is often detrimental to the host. Parasites usually don't kill their host, but can cause disease if the parasite burden is high enough. For example, the most important group of parasites is protozoa. This is the microscopic unicellular eukaryotes that are usually motile. They move using a tail or foot-like process. Different species have a predilection for living in different parts of their human host. The most important protozoa for the USMLE Step 1 Medical Board exam are malaria, babesiosis, toxoplasmosis, Cryptosporidium, and Giardia Lamblia. We will cover each of them individually in this video. The other main group of parasites that cause disease in humans is the helminths, or worms. However, they are largely low-yield material, so we will just briefly cover this group towards the end of the video. We will start with malaria, which I give a high-yield rating of 4 on a scale from 1 to 10, based on a number of factors, including how frequently this topic appears in retired Step 1 questions. Malaria is a disease caused by the Plasmodium protozoa that is transmitted by mosquitoes. The most common species are Plasmodium falciparum, Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium ovale, and Plasmodium malariae. Each of these has slightly different characteristics, but for the most part, these differences are beyond the scope of Step 1. There is a very complex life cycle, but learning all of those details isn't necessary for the exam. When inside a human host, these parasites mainly reside inside red blood cells. Clinically, malaria presents with reoccurring cycles of spiking fevers and chills with other non-specific symptoms like headaches and sweating. These attacks are interspersed with periods of complete remission. The paroxysmal symptomatic periods of different species of malaria occur at different frequencies, but in general, the attacks occur every couple of days or so. Symptoms occur when mature schizons rupture erythrocytes, releasing immature merozoites. Anemia may be present due to the rupture of red blood cells. Question stems almost always mention recent travel to a place like Africa or Latin America, as malaria is not endemic to the United States. One interesting correlation is that sickle cell trait offers some resistance to certain malaria species. This is why sickle cell trait and disease is much more common in areas where malaria is endemic. Sickle cell trait actually gives a survival advantage due to its anti-malarial property. A peripheral blood smear will show enlarged RBCs with numerous small parasite dots on gheme sustain. Here's a picture of the histology. You don't need to be able to identify specific stages or species, but on the left we have mature schizons containing merozoites, and on the right you can see ring-shaped trophozoites. Antimalarials are a class of medication that can be used prophylactically to prevent malaria, used to treat identified or suspected malaria, or used to periodically treat populations in endemic areas. The most commonly used antimalarials are chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, mefloquine, and primaquine. Quinine is primarily used for severe cases of malaria. Doxycycline also has some action against malaria and is most often used for prophylaxis. Most of the antimalarials have quin in the name, which makes it easy to pick out of a list. The mechanisms of these drugs is beyond the scope of the USMLE Step 1 exam. Resistance to antimalarial medications is common and a huge public health concern. Different areas of the world have different resistance patterns, which help dictate which drug should be used as a first-line treatment. Combination therapy is often used now to prevent resistance and recurrence. For example, combining chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine with primaquine is a common combination treatment. Monotherapy is usually sufficient for chemoprophylaxis or prevention. There are also non-pharmacologic preventative measures. Spraying insecticides, using personal protective clothing or mosquito repellents, draining areas of standing water to destroy mosquito habitats, and using bed nets can decrease patient exposure to mosquitoes. Babesia microti is a protozoa infection of the red blood cells similar to malaria. It is usually asymptomatic, but in some patients, babesiosis can present with similar symptoms to malaria. It is transmitted by the Ixodes tick that is also the vector for Lyme disease. Like Lyme disease, Babesia is largely found in the Northeast United States. The gastrointestinal protozoa include Cryptosporidium, Giardia Lamblia, and Entameoba Histolytica. All three are primarily spread via ingestion of cysts in contaminated water, aka fecal-oral transmission, and all three present with diarrhea. Cryptosporidium presents as watery diarrhea, primarily in the AIDS patients. Only symptomatic treatment is needed. Oocysts may be found in the stool on acid fast stain. Here's a picture of Cryptosporidium oocysts in stool on acid fast staining. Giardia lamblia presents with bloating, cramping, flatulence, and fatty floating stools. Recent camping or hiking is often mentioned in the question stem. Metronidazole is the treatment of choice. On stool histology, Giardia can be seen as a symmetric pear-shaped trophozoite. Here is a picture of the Giardia lamblia trophozoite. Entamoeba histolytica presents as bloody diarrhea and intestinal ulcerations. Metronidazole is the treatment of choice. Histologic examination of the stool shows trophozoites which have ingested red blood cells. Here is a picture of that histology. Metronidazole is an antimicrobial medication that has antiprotozoal activity against Trichomonas, Giardia lamblia, and Entamoeba histolytica. It is also frequently used for C. diff, bacterial vaginosis, and H. pylori. Despite the azole ending in the name, metronidazole is not used as an antifungal medication like many other azoles. A common side effect is inhibition of alcohol metabolism. This disulfiram-like reaction leads to an exaggerated effect even when a small amount of alcohol is consumed. You will remember from our earlier video on alcohol metabolism that disulfiram is a medication used to treat alcoholism, as it gives them a really bad hangover if they drink any alcohol. Toxoplasmosis, aka Toxoplasma gondii, is a parasite that primarily causes brain abscesses or cysts in HIV patients with a CD4 T cell count less than 200. In the United States, this protozoa usually infects a human host after they eat undercooked pork or are exposed to cat feces. Infections are usually asymptomatic and then can become reactivated when the patient becomes immunocompromised. The symptoms depend on where the lesion is. Toxoplasmosis can present as a headache with a wide variety of neurological deficits, but seizures are most common. On MRI or CT scan, The lesions present as ring enhancing, meaning it is a low-density circular area surrounded by a white, high-density rim. Given my copyright limitations, I was not able to find an actual picture of toxo, but I have a couple examples of other diseases that cause ring-enhancing lesions here. These look relatively close to toxo, but you should consult your textbooks or a Google image search for better pictures. Toxoplasmosis can cross the placenta and affect the fetus, but I will discuss this topic in a separate video covering the torch infections. I'm also not going to cover trichomonas in this video, even though it is a protozoa. I'm going to make an entire video about vulvovaginal infections, so that information will end up there. Most helminths or worms are not going to be covered in my videos since they are relatively low yield. However, I'm going to quickly touch on a couple key topics. Pinworm, aka Enterobius vermiculus, is a type of roundworm or nematode. Infection occurs through the ingestion of eggs in food. It is the most common helminth infection in the US and is primarily seen in children. Patients are asymptomatic except for severe perianal itching. This itching is caused when the worms that live in the intestine migrate during the night and deposit their eggs outside the anus. Diagnosis is made by cellophane tape test, aka Scotch tape test. Here, a piece of clear adhesive tape is applied to the perianal area and then examined microscopically to look for eggs or adult worms. Mebendazole or albendazole are the first-line treatment for most worm infections. They are both broad-spectrum antihelminths that inhibit microtubule formation and decrease nutrient uptake by the worm. Despite the azole ending to the word, these medications are not in the antifungal azole class. A mnemonic to remember these medications is that worms are bendy. That brings us to the end of the video. Please do comment below if you have any feedback, comments, or suggestions. Getting the number of comments up on the videos really helps us out. If you're watching on a computer and you would like to be taken directly to the next video, you can click on this black box here. The next video in the microbio section is going to cover vulvovaginal infections like BV, Trichomonas, and Candida. Thank you so much for watching, and good luck with the rest of your studying.